We found that about 1 in 5 employees feel their leader regularly expresses his or her doubts about them and their work. Interesting. Interesting what happens as a result of that. Well, thank you. This is great being with you here today. It's a pleasure also listening to some of the previous remarks. I think it's super enlightening. It's good to get away from our jobs for a minute and just rethink, where are we going? What are we working on? Are we headed in the right direction? And I think these serve as really great places to do that. As was mentioned, we do a lot of research at the O.C. Tanner Company. We're the largest employee recognition and workplace culture company in the world, and that's what we do a lot of. Part of that is drawing from a ton of research that we do. Shane mentioned doing a lot of interviews. We do the same. We do basically a huge global workplace study that includes over 20,000 employees. We do dozens and dozens of interviews, focus groups, to better understand through the lens of an employee, what is their employee experience like? What is the culture like? How much does it enable their best work? How much does it restrict and get in the way of their innovation and their confidence in accomplishing the goals that we hope that they accomplish? And so I wanted to share just a couple of insights with you today and really unpack some of what we're learning about the employee experience. I think everywhere I go around the world, I hear HR leaders working on some side of employee experience and workplace culture. And it's interesting as I look at what are the frameworks that seem to be the core of what people are using to lay out their employee experience work. And it's probably most common that it follows a typical employee life cycle. And this is, again, no surprise, right? Employee experience design came right out of customer experience design, which has been around for years and years and years, where you start with the first time, or even before the first time, a customer hears about you, all the way through the cycle, the buying cycle of a customer, and then on into adoption of a product, and then advocacy. That same sort of model has been leveraged in HR, right? Starting with attraction, recruitment, onboarding, development, retention, et cetera. And that's a fairly useful method to lay out that entire employee experience and then target which of the areas that you feel deserve the most amount of work to affect that employee experience. But it's very interesting. Employees don't view it that way at all. In fact, 92% of employees view their own employee experience as the thousands and thousands of experiences they have every day. And most of them don't really intersect with most of the stages in a career life cycle model. And most of them are thinking and considering, what does their employee experience look like? We found that 42% of all employees worldwide viewed their experience as positive. When you break it down and analyze what's actually happening, this is just something we were trying to visualize from the data. And that was, you see those green circles up there with a plus in them represent a standout positive employee experience. And the negative ones are obviously the standout negative ones. The vast majority, over 85% of experiences that we have every day, both at work and in our personal lives, are actually quite forgettable. They're not memorable at all. They just seem to happen in the flow of our everyday work lives. And so they're not memorable. But it's interesting, when you ask people to rate their overall experience, just like I would if I asked you to do that, what you would do, because your mind cannot process thousands and thousands of experiences over the last month, but what you can do and what your mind does a quick job of is it scans through your experiences, most of which are not memorable, and it looks for the outliers, those that are uniquely positive or those that are uniquely negative. And then that ends up coloring everything else. So for example, somebody who has a great experience, that project was one of my greatest accomplishments, that's a standout peak moment. That ends up, when they think about that, that ends up coloring so many of the other experiences that they have. They essentially has this halo effect. As you think about that positive experience, it creates a powerful view of an overall positive experience at your organization. So it's these micro experiences that ultimately form the basis of people's understanding and their own reference about whether or not they have a positive work environment and if they work in a positive culture or not. So these standouts are really interesting. It's interesting too to observe, when I ask a lot of HR leaders literally around the world, where are you spending most of your time? Most HR leaders will target the red dots, the places that are irritants, the places that they hear most complaining about. And that tends to be where we go put all of our energy. Now think about it for a while. If you do a spectacular job on eliminating a previous red dot experience that a lot of employees are having, where's the most likely outcome after your work is complete? Where does that red dot move to? It moves to pretty much neutral. If you do a spectacular job with you and your team, you might get that red dot all the way up to completely forgettable, unmemorable. Interesting to think about, because I see the majority of organizations chasing those red dot experiences. Now, I'm not saying just ignore them. You have to tackle some of these issues. But I would advocate for a much more balanced approach between what are you doing to actively create those green dot experiences as well as eliminate some of those red dot ones. That makes sense? I just see so much going right after go chase the problem irritating areas of workplace culture, which again, don't do much in terms of driving retention, talent attraction, all the kinds of broader objectives that you're chasing. Interestingly enough, we also in the data this last year try to tease out what's actually happening. What's the typical shelf life of a positive, standout positive experience compared to a standout negative experience? And we found something that actually surprised us. We saw that those standout positive experiences actually have a shelf life of about 4 weeks on average. Now, obviously, you can have an extreme standout that's going to last for several months. But on average, we saw these standout positive experiences lasting about 4 weeks compared to the negative ones lasting 2 weeks. And that was interesting to us. And in fact, if you pick a moment in time where there was a positive experience, it casts not only a halo effect on the 2 weeks after that, but when they are asked to recall their overall employee experience, it casts a positive shadow on the 2 weeks before that actual standout moment. And again, the same thing over here on the negatives, only it's much shorter. It has about a week on each side of the actual moment that they had a negative experience. Interesting, isn't it? I think, and when you ask the question, why is it that the positive ones stand out so much more and last longer? Any thoughts about that? Just out of curiosity, what sort of goes through your mind about why we think, I don't have the data to support the exact why. Yeah. Endorphins are very, very powerful. Absolutely. Any other thoughts? Yeah. They want to be inspired at work. This connects to what Shane talked about, right? Why is it that a leader's most powerful role of establishing a movement is so eliciting of people's engagement levels? Because they want to be inspired. They want to go change the world in some way, whatever that domain is. It's very interesting. I also think part of what's going on here is that work is work. People's expectation around work is different on a Monday morning than it is when you start a weekend on a Saturday morning, right? Part of it is the expectation around work is it's going to be hard, it's going to be challenging. I'm going to expect to have problems and challenges along the way. And so I think when there's a standout positive experience, it's quite unexpected. It's not something that they baked into their day-to-day expectation, and hence the standout sort of experience. They're very, very powerful. They affect people in very powerful ways. If you scan back across your entire career, what will be those standout moments? Most of them will be the most positive moments when you really made a difference, when you did some great work. It's interesting to sort of contemplate. So what are we doing individually and as culture designers in our company, experience designers, what are we doing to maximize and to increase the number of those positive standout peak moments? That's to me the big question that I would ask you to really consider, because I think there's a lot of room out there to tackle things that are making a difference. One of those is a recognition experience. When somebody is recognized, called out for accomplishing something extraordinary for the organization or for the team, it's not just powerful to the employee, to the receiver of that recognition. It also creates multiple ripple effects. The giver themselves, the giver of the recognition, whether that be a leader or a peer, if we track their engagement levels, they spike as well. And it really begs the question, is it better to give than receive when it comes to recognition? And if you do that publicly, the observer also picks up all kinds of positive experiences from sharing in that success and from understanding our company cares about success, calls it out, appreciates it, recognizes it when it happens. That we don't just ignore when people actually go to that extra step. They are engaged. They invest that discretionary effort. They bring about a change that everybody loves. You can't have radio silence when that happens. And so each of these represent different employee experiences that are fueled by a moment. And those moments, again, count for an awful lot in people's careers. So this begs the question, which experiences are most meaningful to employees? If employees are asked, do you work in a culture that's thriving, that enables your success? And then you drill into that to discover what are those core dimensions of thriving workplace cultures, and you overlay that against experiences, you see something like this. We found that 6 core dimensions of culture were most important to employees. A lot of people look top down when they come at looking at culture. This looks bottom up, saying through the lens of the employee, what really matters to them? Purpose. Purpose is not just mission statement, right? Purpose is connecting to something that's emotive, to something that's worthwhile, answering the why behind their work. To me, that why is so essential, especially for younger employees. They want to know, if I'm going to do this, if I'm going to dig deep and go innovate and break through and come up with things that are going to ultimately create new value for the organization or breakthrough thinking, why? What's inspiring me to do that? If we do our job right on purpose, it answers the why question. It's becoming a bigger and bigger deal, especially to younger employees. Opportunity is another key one. Not just the opportunity to move up in the career sort of ladder, but to develop more skills, to have more opportunity available for them to grow into. That's vital for people. Again, if they feel like they've got a dead-end job where they can project out 5 years from now and look at that picture and it doesn't look good, they want to know that they can continue to grow. Success is something we just don't talk about nearly enough. For employees, it's vital that they feel like I'm part of a winning team. I feel progress. I feel like I'm seeing success around me. At a team level and all the way laddering up into an organizational level. We don't talk about it a lot. You can't believe how many employees cannot answer the question, what does success look like in my role, on my team? They literally don't know. Why? Because we've all defined people's work by a series of tasks on their job description. That's not what success looks like. That's what the tasks are that you're responsible to deliver. I think we can do collectively a lot better job at signaling this is what success looks like. Appreciation, absolutely foundational. People feel like if I am valued when I contribute and when I succeed, boy, I got a lot more where that came from. if there's no expression of appreciation, if I do not feel like my contributions matter or are noticed or are cared about, one of two things happen. Either people choose to reduce their amount of energy and effort that they expend toward their work and their innovation, or they leave and go find someplace where they will be valued. It's becoming really, really clear to people. Next is well-being. Well-being is a sense that people care about you as a person, not just you as a unit of labor, not just a cog in the machine. I loved one of the comments made earlier about inclusion. This to me is core here. I can bring my whole self to work. I can bring my whole value, and that there's some reciprocation. If I'm going to dig deep for you, I hope you provide some flexibility back for me when I need it. And people are asking that and looking for that and expecting that much more now than ever before. And leadership, wow, you know, what an absolutely vital part of what employees expect to have in their organizations. And I want to drill in to some of our research on leadership. I think you'll find it quite interesting about what the expectation shift is happening with employees. And I think with leadership, there is a huge sea change. I'm seeing a massive sea change. I mean, gee, we've studied leadership now for decades, and all of the information has pointed to some of the strengths of good leaders versus bad. But what's changed? Why is it different now? What's happening now in the last couple of years that really we haven't seen happen before? One, younger employees are simply rejecting traditional, outdated leadership practices. For those who were boomers or Gen X, came into the workforce, looked around, and had to deal with what was there. And for whatever reason, assumed they couldn't radically change that. Millennials and Gen Z are simply not dealing with that. They're coming into the organization going, yeah, we're not following that. How do you even allow that kind of leadership to still exist in our organization? It's just running up. I was in Mumbai meeting with one of the largest insurance companies in India, and he said, our model has been so successful year after year after year of how we bring new recruits in, how we train them through a specific process, and turn them into high-performing individuals. He said, the last couple of years, it feels like that is breaking down. Those new recruits that are coming in simply aren't following the leadership that has been in place for so long. It takes followership to work for leadership. And the followership side of this, people are rejecting it. Power is also shifting from managers to teams. We've talked about collaborative work environments for how many years now? It's actually starting to happen. As soon as teams have a lot more investment and ability to make decisions, the power of the manager actually reduces. And that gets invested and shared much more significantly by teams. In the US, 10,000 baby boomers are retiring every single day. Have been for several years and will for another 5 to 7 years. So it's very interesting. That's creating a vacuum in which others are stepping in and taking over the leadership reins of an organization. And finally, I think most significantly, employees have a voice and they have information. And they're acting on that information. I'm not seeing that in every organization yet, but boy, this wave is just spreading across the world. Leadership demands, the expectations of what a good leader is fundamentally shifting. And I think most organizations are fairly ill-equipped to handle this transition. Some of the other things we found that about 1 in 5 employees feel their leader regularly expresses his or her doubts about them and their work. Interesting. Interesting what happens as a result of that. 26%, so about 1/4 of employees, feel their leader strongly encourages collaboration. How long have we all talked about collaboration and bringing the silos down and the walls down and working together in cross-functional teams? Only 1/4 of leaders are actually leading out that that's an important thing. That siloing is being protected by leaders for the most part. About half of them, just less than half, feel their leader works to develop them, and over half feel their leader will not give up control over anything. Interesting. That's a challenge. This is some of the things that we saw as we started breaking out the differences between older style traditional leadership and modern leadership from a behavioral standpoint. It became really clear what was happening. If you look on this side, the traditional leadership, it's around directing the work. It's around a presumption that the leader knows best what the team needs to do and what each individual member on the team needs to actually pull off. That directing role has been endemic in leadership for centuries, probably even millennia. Also, the sense that they're in the best position to evaluate the effectiveness of the employee, which comes in the form of evaluations and reviews, annually or more frequently. They are also view their role as a gatekeeper, one who holds on to information because that's a source of their power. What they know is not known by their team members, so that gives them that extra power to be able to manage a team. That way of thinking, that mindset, is what's grating so many younger employees. Because younger employees are expecting something very different. And if you look at the modern leadership side, when you ask employees all around the world, what are you looking for with leadership? You inevitably hear, I want somebody who will mentor me, coach me, help me navigate through the projects and difficulties and challenges of my work experience. That's what they want most. They also want somebody to help develop their skills, help them become more valuable tomorrow than they are today. And finally, they want somebody to be a connector, not a gatekeeper. Somebody who's actually going to connect them to purpose, connect them to opportunity, connect them to all of those core dimensions of thriving workplace cultures. That's what people are looking for. And so the role is different, the mindset's different. And we ask ourselves, well, how is it that this just keeps perpetuating? Why is it that after years and years of talking about different leadership styles, we still see this? Well, where did traditional leaders get their training from? From a traditional leader they had. And where did they get theirs from? A traditional leader they had. So this is a cultural norm that's been passed through from leadership generation to leadership generation. And finally, we're at a point where that's now radically shifting and people are just saying, enough of that. It's time now to design our leadership experiences to be way more shared and to get leaders to understand that the whole model of their own leadership necessarily changes or what? Or they become completely irrelevant. And I think that's exactly what we're seeing, and that's exactly what I'm hearing from so many around the world. This is what shocked me. As we laid out the definitions of a modern leader and a traditional leader, and we actually tracked across every one of these core elements of their culture, it was shocking. So the mean, the average, right in the middle, would be zero. Okay? So look at traditional leadership, the lens of their own employee experience, -43%, compared to with modern leadership practices, +55%. Go down every single one of these dimensions of purpose, appreciation, engagement levels. Look at the difference with engagement levels. It's fundamental. Burnout. Burnout is the opposite, so that flips. Traditional leadership enhances and encourages higher levels of burnout. Versus modern leadership, you see significantly lower levels of burnout. Every single one of these metrics that we tracked, look at the difference. So it's not just, oh, well, that leader's maybe a hard leader to work with. You just got to deal with that. Look at the damage being done when you leave a traditional manager in place. And that damage is felt all the way through that team, all the way to the results that they lead. So I think it's becoming much more clear. We've got to make that shift. We've got to help leaders better understand what the expectation is now and how different that is from what they've had modeled to them for years and years. One of the core dimensions we found in the data that seemed to really affect people's perceptions of a positive leader or not, and whether they were connected or not, was this issue of one-to-ones. These more casual, conversations with leaders and employees in that one-to-one setting, and not waiting for some high-stakes, supercharged environment during a performance review to try to build that connection. Everybody hates those. The manager hates them. The employee hates them. And think about the relationship in a performance review. I'm not against performance reviews. You have to manage and understand somebody's performance if you're going to figure out how much raise to give them or bonuses, etc. But if that's the primary source of connection, it's so lopsided, it's going to get damaged in the relationship between the manager and the employee, because the employee is so disadvantaged in that setting, because the manager gets to express all of their power in that setting. The employee really has no power in that setting. And so you can't build a relationship in that setting. What we found is that 33% of employees dread meeting with their leader. Dread it. A third of people dread it. Why? So much of it is because of the nature of the interaction. What we found was, when you look at meaningful versus non-meaningful interactions in the one-to-ones, if you go heavily leader-oriented, in other words, the leader sets the tone, they set the agenda, they're the ones driving the one-to-one, the meaningfulness is incredibly low for that employee. No surprise, right? Think about any other relationship you have. Think about the relationship with your spouse or partner. If you go say, hey, I want to have a one-to-one with you, and by the way, I'm going to be the one who's going to decide exactly what we're going to talk about and how we're going to talk about that, how well do you think that's going to go, right? But for some reason, in a work setting, somehow, how did we get there, right? Somehow it's, oh, that's just how it is. No, if you swing it all the way to the other side and say, no, make the employee the one who sets the agenda and sets the discussion topics in a one-to-one, you get equally low meaningfulness scores, because they want to know what the manager thinks too, right? And so the apex, the ideal, is in this co-created environment where both the manager and the employee gets to share in the conversation about what they talk about and where and how. When leaders do this right, when leaders connect to their employees to purpose, to accomplishment, and each other, you see huge increases in the odds that an employee will highly rate their employee experience, increase in the net promoter scores, huge increase in engagement levels, and massive increases in the perception of positive leadership. Just simply leader as connector to purpose and vision and opportunity, connection to each other. That's what people are craving and wanting and expecting out of good leadership. And when you analyze great leaders, and you know, Shane talked about several today, you analyze what's actually the mechanisms behind those. So much of it is connecting people to something way bigger than themselves that allows them to more fully engage. Finally, as we wrap up and prepare for some questions, again, when you're thinking about designing experiences, these micro experiences that shape the perceptions and the work experience of your employees, these are pretty good target areas to chase, whether it be leadership. Where can we create? How can we create some of those green dot breakout positive moments in leadership? How do we create them around appreciation? How do we create them? It serves as a pretty nice compass to be able to target those, measure those, see exactly how your employees are feeling, and it affects their outcomes. It affects their ability to really feel connected to your organization and create a thriving place that allows for, when the recruiter comes tapping them on the shoulder, they're very happy. They feel very deeply connected to their team, to their organization. And I think that's part of our role. As I mentioned, we have this global culture report that we have available in our booth. So you're welcome to come by and grab one of those and be able to see. I've just covered a tip of the iceberg today. But hopefully you found this valuable as you think about designing your own cultures and strengthening them and editing out those elements of culture that are simply not good for your organization, that are holding you back, and amping up those dimensions of your culture that you really want to purposefully shape. And that's why I think culture by design, not culture by accident, is where most leading HR people are going.